So recently, the infectious department, infectious disease department conducted a quiz program for our residents on hand hygiene. The first prize went to Dr. Harini and Abhinaya Devi from Onco. The second prize went to Dr. Rajesh from Ortho and Dr. Sandhya from International Patient Services. Third prize to Dr. Kevin, General Medicine, and Dr. Rajesh from CCU. Dr. Kevin, may I invite Dr. Jayanti to hand over the prizes to the winner. The other two prizes have been given, the third prize. Thank you, madam. So I'm very sure people from Tamil Nadu at least will know this famous doctor, Dr. Muthulakshmi Reddy. Some facts about Dr. Muthulakshmi Reddy: that she was the first female student to study in men's college in Pudukottai. When she was taken for admission, the principal refused admission because it's a men's college, but their parents were very much interested to continue her academic growth. So the Maharaja of the Pudukottai accepted her candidature as a special candidate. And she was the first woman house surgeon in government maternity and ophthalmic hospital, Chennai. And she did her undergraduation from Madras Medical College. She was the first woman legislator of India in 1926 in British India. And she founded the Adyar Cancer Institute, and she was the founding president of Women in India Association, WIA, which also administers Adyar Cancer Institute. And in 1954, it was the second facility for exclusively for cancer next to Tata Cancer Hospital. And today it has been taken over by Dr. Shanta, and she's been conducting in a very excellent way, catering services to 80,000 plus cancer patients in a year. So these are the women who have contributed immensely to the field of medicine. And with Dr. Muthulakshmi's name, there is a scheme in Tamil Nadu government which gives some monetary help to pregnant women of around 20,000 rupees a month during their pregnancy. So we have Dr. Sandhya, the Sharky Sandhya, captain of Shark team, to talk about aging gracefully. She's a consulting gynecologist in our hospital.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. So aging is inevitable, okay? Nobody can stop aging. But it is an option how we age. So I restrict myself only to females. So in women, there is various age. I mean, the women go through different stages of her life, from infancy to childhood. And menarche, which is a major event in a female, and then there is a reproductive life, and then menopause and postmenopause. So if you see in a woman, okay, so menarche is a major event in a female's life, which usually occurs between 12 to 14 years, two years plus or minus, either way. So once menarche, then they go into the reproductive life, and then there is this menopause, which is another major event in a female's life, preceded with perimenopause and postmenopause. When I restrict myself today to menopause, so menopause, it is a retrospective diagnosis. Okay, so once she had stopped a period for 12 consecutive months, then we tell it is as a menopause. And mainly why menopause occurs, because of the cessation of the ovarian function and decrease in the estrogen and progesterone levels. So in menopause, if you see, there are various stages. So this menopause, it's a natural transition in the life, and it can begin anywhere between 35 to 55 years. The median age for menopause is 51 to 52 years, again plus or minus 2 years. So once in menopause, there are various stages. she can go through the perimenopause. Okay. This one, yeah. Okay, so there is this perimenopause and there is the menopause and postmenopause. So when we come individually, what is perimenopause? Usually starts in late 40s and it lasts for 3 to 5 years prior to her menopause. And usually they will have this menstrual complaints, most of them, various types of menstrual complaints. It can be irregular periods in the form of short periods or longer periods, extremely decreased bleeding or heavy bleeding or amenorrhea, and they can have a few other menstrual complaints or menopausal symptoms also. And so I've already told the menopause, usually the age is between 51 to 52 years, but sometimes there can be early menopause due to reasons like hysterectomy. It's obvious there's no uterus, so there is no menses. Oophorectomy also, if they have not given any HRT, then when there is oophorectomy, is removal of both the ovaries. So there is no estrogen and progesterone in the body, so then they don't get their menses. There's something called as premature ovarian failure. This is when the menopause occurs before the age of 40 years. It can occur due to various reasons. One of the most important is the Turner syndrome, and other than that, due to any cancer treatment or surgery. Now, before we go into menopause as such, I would like to just highlight on this slide, which shows the hormones in the woman's body. So we all know hypothalamus, it secretes GnRH, which stimulates the anterior pituitary to secrete FSH and LH, which in turn stimulates the ovaries to secrete estrogen and progesterone. In the estrogen in the follicular phase and progesterone in the luteal phase, and these are inhibitory to the this estrogen and progesterone are inhibitory to the anterior pituitary, so it decreases the FSH and LH levels. And there's something called as inhibin, which is a very important hormone which plays a vital role in menopause. This inhibin B is secreted from the follicles, which has got an inhibitory effect on FSH levels. So during menopause, what happens? The follicles are depleted. So when the follicles are depleted, the inhibin B level is decreased, which in turn causes increase in the FSH level. So when inhibin B is decreased, FSH is increased. FSH in the initial stages will stimulate the ovaries to secrete increased estrogen. So initially, whatever follicles are there, it will increase the estrogen level. But over a period of time, once the follicles are depleted, there is decrease in estrogen and progesterone, and the negative feedback is gone. Therefore, there is increase in FSH and LH, which is a hallmark of menopause, that there is increase in FSH and LH. So by now we know that the two important hormones in a woman's life is estrogen and progesterone. So both are having actually opposite effects. Estrogen is the most important hormone, but when there is excess estrogen, it causes damage. When there is decreased estrogen also, it is bad. So there should be a balance between estrogen and progesterone. So if you see the effects of estrogen on the body, it has effects in various in all the levels in the body. So if you see in the brain, it helps in maintaining the temperature and also memory. In the heart, it regulates the cholesterol levels. And in the ovaries, it obviously helps in menstrual cycle. In the vagina, it will stimulate the maturation of the epithelium. It maintains the lubrication. It maintains the vaginal pH and hence decreases the chance of infection. In the bones, it helps in preserving the bone density. In the uterus, it obviously prepares the uterus to nourish a developing fetus, and it helps in breast development and future milk production during the childbirth. So when in menopause, what happens? There is deficiency of this estrogen, which will lead to all the menopausal symptoms. So the heart, they become vulnerable to cardiac problems, cholesterol levels are varied, there is no ovary, so there is no pregnancy, uterus is not there, there is no menses, vagina because it becomes dry because of decrease in the secretions. In the brain, there is disturbed body temperature leading to hot flushes, breast size decreases, skin becomes dry and the bone weakens. So this is a estrogen level in the body. So the estrogen level is at its peak at the age of 35 years, and then the estrogen level comes down. So the estrogen, these estrogen which is there even after menopause is because of the peripheral estrogen which is converted from androgen to estrogen. Now we come to the pathophysiology. This one slide will tell you all the symptoms of menopause. So if you see there, when there is decreased estrogen in the CNS, it causes vasomotor instability. Okay, there is decrease in the norepinephrine and serotonin, which causes abnormality in the thermoregulatory system, which leads to hot flushes, night sweats, and sleep disturbances, and which in turn again leads to depression and daytime fatigue. In the urogenital system, if you see, there is decrease in the collagen, which causes weakening of the vaginal walls, which is a reason for stress incontinence and the pelvic organ prolapse, which we see most commonly in the postmenopausal women. And in the urogenital system, it also causes decrease in the blood flow, therefore causes decrease in glycogen production, and hence the vaginal pH increases, secretion is decreased, hence they are more prone for dryness and irritation and infections and dyspareunia. In the cardiovascular, you have seen that it causes a lot of variation in the cholesterol levels, and hence there is increased risk of atherosclerosis in the postmenopausal women. Estrogen is a protective hormone. That's why before menopause, the women are less prone for MI or any hard cardiac events. In the bone, again, there is more of bone resorption compared to bone formation, so leading to osteoporosis. So if you come to what are the menopausal symptoms, as I already told you, the vasomotor symptoms, musculoskeletal, mood effects on mood, urogenital and sexual difficulties. So if you come to the musculoskeletal symptoms, so there is osteoporosis, which is because the estrogen, there is more of bone degeneration than bone formation, leading to osteoporosis. The mood swings, it can vary from various symptoms, from sadness to anxiety to hopelessness, irritability, various complaints they can have because of the hormonal imbalance. Now, vaginal dryness, atrophy will lead to the decrease in the vaginal lining, will lead to they are more prone for infections, and it also causes dyspareunia. There is loss of libido, again because of lack of sexual desire, and again vaginal dryness and pain, all reasons for decrease in the libido. Now if you come to HRT, the benefits of HRT are there especially for hot flashes, but not so effective in menopausal symptoms. So if you see HRT, what are the definite benefits of HRT? It will definitely help you in the vasomotor symptoms and in genitourinary. Genitourinary, usually we give a local treatment. Osteoporosis, to certain extent, yes, it will help you to decrease the incidence of fractures. But what are the definitive risks of taking HRT? It causes increased incidence of endometrial cancer, causes increased incidence of venous thromboembolism, breast cancer. So the risk of cardiovascular problem and breast cancer with HRT is much more than the benefits. So we think 10 times before we give HRT to a patient. So don't regret growing older. It's a privilege which is denied to many of us. So other than HRT, what else we can do to age gracefully? Okay, so we can put all the creams over the face and Botox to decrease the age, but it is the hormones, the gut health and the inflammation levels which are the influencing factors in the rate at which the cells age. Stress, sleep and nutrition play a huge role in how your skin looks and how it ages. There's a hell lot of difference between a chronological age and a biological age depending on your lifestyle factors. So the eight things are, one is protective hormones, that is to have a balance between estrogen, progesterone, testosterone levels, which can happen if you follow the rest of the things. One is have a good, fully nourished diet. So there's these magnesium, vitamin C, sulfur, zinc, selenium, vitamin A, omega 3 fatty acids and vitamin E, which are all certain minerals found in few food items, which are very good for maintaining a good nutritious diet. And you should avoid low protein diets or low fat diet. Even the essential fatty acids are required for a glowing skin. Lower the stress. Yes, stress can pump out the hormone, that is cortisol level in our body. Once the cortisol levels are high, it consumes these magnesium, selenium, etc. faster than when the cortisol levels are low. So the stress factor has to be reduced, and sleep. Lack of sleep is a stressor to the body. It can influence your ability to create hormones like progesterone and estrogen. So the balance is disturbed when there is lack of sleep. Gut issues, nutrient deficiencies, emotional stress, and HPO axis dysfunction can all lead to poor sleep. And eat anti-inflammatory, that is excessive intake of inflammatory foods like refined sugars and wheat has also got shown to be a stressor on the both the gut and the cells. And look at the ingredients when you buy some so from the stores. What are the chemicals present in that when you apply on your face as well as when you use it on your take it internally. So successful aging is always better. So for successful aging, you should have 10 things. One is have good relationship, friendship, family, everything. Keep learning, focus on the process, be resilient and engaged in life, face pressure on head, be a problem solver, reinvent yourself regularly, exercise just matter, be positive and never underestimate yourself. Thank you.
Any questions or comments? Lower stress means only Narendra Modi and Vajpayee can be without any stress, madam, isn't it? Okay. Anything?